Dr. Joseph Chuman. He's one of our three leaders and also the leader of the Bergen Society. He has a doctorate in religion from Columbia University and teaches seminars there in religion and human rights. We in Ethical Culture are especially proud of his work for those who have been detained while seeking refuge in the United States. Joe has located people willing to open their homes, and he has opened his own to those who have been held in the Elizabeth Detention Center in Elizabeth, New Jersey. We are especially proud of all the work that he has done for these unfortunate people. Now, today, Dr. Chuman is speaking on the philosophic underpinnings of President Obama. Joe.
Thank you. Darn it, she stole my thunder. I thought we were going to really surprise her with another rendition of Happy Birthday. There you go. I'm just not swift enough on my feet. Well, yes, it is true. I turned 65 yesterday, and as of March 1st, actually went on Medicare, so don't mess with me. It's the first time in my adult life I actually look forward to getting older. That has been true, I think, since I 16, but it's good to still be alive, and it's good to be with you on a beautiful, beautiful spring-like day. Yeah, I want to talk about Barack Obama, but I don't want to talk so much directly about his politics, but about his philosophical values that underlie his politics. Like soothsayers reading the entrails of dead birds, the media pundits held forth on the significance of Barack Obama's second inaugural address and what it prophesied for his last term in office. Indeed, Barack Obama is like a Rorschach figure onto which people at different ends of the political spectrum project their own ideas, hopes, and fears as to who he really is. To people on the far right, Obama is a despised socialist. For people on the left, he's an inspired liberal. I personally think that Obama is more of a centrist than a liberal. But for many who want to believe that he is indeed a fulfillment of their progressive hopes, Obama's second inaugural address gave them considerable warrant. For many, it was a much-awaited declaration of his presumed liberalism, long shackled by the obstructionism of a Republican opposition that has treated him like enemy number one. For those who believe in him, Obama's speech came as a powerful blast of fresh air, a bomb salving the disappointments of his first term in office. Maybe at last, with nothing to lose, Obama will reveal his true colors as a stalwart progressive and finally come into his own, or so it is hoped by many. There may be some justifications, in fact, for this hope. With the decisive defeat of Mitt Romney after a painful slugfest of a campaign, Obama has forced a weakened Republican Party to re-examine its own strategy and its very identity, lest it consign itself to extinction. By gaining a second term, Obama has proven that a black man winning the highest office was not merely a fluke, and with his victory, it's perhaps a symbol that America has truly changed, demographically for sure, and maybe, just maybe, politically as well. I am convinced that when Obama ran in 2008, he believed that the sun was setting on Reaganism with its contempt for government and its economic presumptions that by further enriching the rich, all boats will be lifted. With his recent victory, we can hope that Americans have indeed given up on the tired ideology of trickle-down economics with its self-serving notion that if we feed the rich even more, all Americans will be better off. Perhaps Americans have turned a corner on the politics of hatred and fear. Fear of blacks, fear of gays, fear of immigrants, fear of anyone who is different, which the Republican Party, to its shame, has exploited far too long. And we can even hope that Americans are regaining their sanity and rejecting anti-science, rejecting irrationalism and the political influence of extremist religion. Well, maybe, not so sure. Obama's victory and his second inaugural seem to suggest that the ground indeed is shifting, and we are leaving a disturbing past behind and moving, however haltingly, into a more promising future. Nobody can predict the future, but we can hope, nevertheless. When I first heard Obama's address on Inauguration Day, I must confess that I was not particularly impressed. Maybe because the ideas he articulated are ones I have held for very long and nothing sounded new to me. But I took a second look once the pundits got a hold of it and began to describe it as something surprisingly wonderful. What most political commentators came away with was that this speech was a policy declaration for his second term, more in the character of a State of the Union speech than an Inauguration Day address. And many thought it surprising in its putting forward an unabashed liberal agenda, given that liberalism has been such a dirty word for so long. But I would conclude that it was a liberal statement only within the context of the politics of the past three decades. American politics has moved so far to the right that it seemed to some a bold declaration of political liberalism for the president to defend Social Security, which has been a program that is more than 80 years old, and Medicare, which has been part of the American political landscape for nearly 50 years. He defended those programs, and that sounded liberal to many people. But Obama made reference to other items on his agenda, all stated in the briefest terms, given that that speech was only 18 minutes long. As you may recall, perhaps, if you can think back to that January day, while acknowledging the free market in what was no doubt a rebuke to free market zealots, Obama also noted that in order to thrive, the free market needs, quote, rules to ensure competition and fair play, end quote. In what was surely an affirmation of assertive government, he put forward that, quote, we resolve that a great nation must care for the vulnerable and protect its people from life's worst hazards and misfortunes, end quote. In a way that was a swipe at his Republican adversaries and which might make the economist Joseph Stiglitz proud, for Stiglitz has written compellingly on the dangers we face as a result of economic inequality, Obama said, quote, we the people understand that our country cannot succeed when a shrinking few do very well and a growing majority barely make it, end quote. I'll get back to that point a little later on. And in that context, he also made one of his few explicit nods to the reality of poverty. Poverty has been off the political landscape for a very, very long time. I mean, Obama and other politicians recognize that the middle class feels that it's hurting so badly and is hurting so badly that indeed to even mention that there are poor people in this country is indeed to lose the support of the middle class, and that politically it's a very bad strategy to do so, but he did give a nod to poverty in that address. As mentioned, he defended both Social Security, Medicare, as well as Medicaid, while noting in that was no doubt an answer to Mitt Romney, Paul Ryan, and their friends, that such entitlements, quote, do not sap our initiative, they strengthen us. They do not make us a nation of takers, they free us to take risks that make this country great, end quote. On that point especially, I think Obama was spot on. That is correct. Entitlements do not make us weaker, they make us stronger because they give the economic resources to individuals to move ahead and indeed add to the economy in flourishing ways. That's been the history for the most part of entitlements in the United States. And what was perhaps the most surprising declaration, surprising because so little was done in his first term, Obama powerfully acknowledged the reality of climate change and the need to respond with sustainable energy alternatives. He proffered the importance of diplomacy over war, a commitment to democracy in our foreign policy, and a reassertion of America's standing through acts of international charity to help the world's poor, ill, and hungry. And in what was his most talked about point, he elevated the struggle of gays to a bona fide civil rights struggle, equating it with the women's movement and the long march towards the equality of African Americans. This, too, is an inclusion I want to return to in a little bit. He became the first president to acknowledge gays and gay rights in an inaugural address. He reasserted the need for voter equality, perhaps a swipe at all those politically motivated and ugly initiatives towards voter repression during the campaign. In this breath, he acknowledged the aspiration of immigrants, and in an oblique reference to preventing gun violence, he said, quote, our journey is not complete until all our children, from the streets of Detroit to the hills of Appalachia to the quiet lanes of Newtown, know that they are cared for and cherished and always safe from harm, end quote. It was a moving image, almost poetically rendered. But in a harsher assertion, in what I infer was an attack on extremists, gun rights people among them, he asserted very pointedly, and I think very wisely, quote, "We cannot mistake absolutism for principle," end quote. That's a very nice phrase. We cannot mistake absolutism for principle. In a speech that was so very brief, Obama packed a lot of policy commitments. Stylistically, it employed some vaunting rhetoric, which revealed again the author of Dreams from My Father to be a masterful writer. But rhetoric, of course, does not signify the hard political struggles needed to implement these goals, even partially, which of course is part and parcel of political reality. While commentators and others saw Obama's speech as primarily a statement of policy and were struck by its liberalism, I actually saw something else, which, given my own training and inclinations, I found even more interesting than his manifest politics. It is to this that I want to devote the balance of my talk this morning. Beyond politics, I saw Obama's inaugural address as a manifestation of the philosophical ideas that lie beneath his politics, and I believe guide his politics, his political style, and his political choices. Together with the speech he gave on receiving the Nobel Peace Prize, I believe that this speech, the second inaugural, was among the most philosophically rich and revealing that Obama has given, and bespeak who this measured and introspective man is deep down. All of us, I might say, possess a philosophy, even if we have never taken a philosophy course or don't even know what philosophy is. What I mean is that all that we think, say, and do emerge from a deeper orientation or reflect a deeper orientation and template of values that we possess. This remains true even if we are not conscious of these values. If we are reflective, and when asked, many of us can begin to give explanations for why we believe in certain ways or make certain choices, whether these choices relate to which political party and candidates we vote for, how we discipline our children, or whether we save or spend our discretionary income. All these acts and a million others emerge out of ulterior values orientations and can be articulated in the form of reasons and explanations. It is in this sense that we all, I would say, are philosophers. But a few of us are indeed true intellectuals who have studied philosophy and related fields and have been trained to think philosophically. And to the extent possible, we have endeavored to be guided by those philosophical ideas. I submit that Barack Obama is one of those relatively rare individuals. I want to acknowledge a book that I employed in an address here a while back. It's a book called Reading Obama by a Professor James Kloppenberg, who is the chairman of the History Department at Harvard University. In fact, I had the honor of interviewing him here last year for one of our advocacy forums. I was really interested in his book and what he had to say about Obama. It is Kloppenberg's view that we have had only two presidents in the past 100 years who have been true intellectuals. That is, people who are attracted to ideas, are conversant with them, and allow themselves to be actively inspired and guided by ideas. The first was Woodrow Wilson. The second is Barack Obama. What Kloppenberg did is very interesting from the point of view of intellectual biography. What he did was to review every class that Obama took in college. When possible, he interviewed his former professors whom he could locate and interview, and indeed he said he read every article in the Harvard Law Review that was published when Obama was president of the Harvard Law Review in order to grasp and unpack the content of Barack Obama's mind, so to speak. And he said reading all those Law Review articles was a great way to get a good night's sleep. what Kloppenberg discerns are some of the philosophical ideas I find also hidden beneath the surface of Obama's second inaugural address. And what follows is an exposition of a few of those philosophical commitments, those ideas. When Obama moved into the Oval Office, one of the first things he did was to inscribe on the floor of the Oval Office several quotations that he finds personally very inspiring. One from Martin Luther King has since become very well known. Quote, "The moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice." How many people have heard that? Mm-hmm. Anyone? Okay, it's familiar to a few people. Obama has used it in several contexts, okay? And he got it from Martin Luther King. It's a beautiful phrase. "The moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends from slowly and gently upward towards justice." Actually, King, I should say, was not the author of that phrase. King actually purloined it. He stole it from someone else. It was a paraphrase of a statement first written, we should say, with some pride, because it's in a kindred organization, by the Unitarian minister, Theodore Parker, who was a firebrand of abolition in the decades before the Civil War. But that commitment to a slow incremental movement towards a more just society is an idea that guided King, and I argue is shared by Obama. It's the idea that America unfolds from its beginning to a destiny that is more just, but that gradual process is not automatic, it is not determined. It requires human input and effort. If one wants to peg Obama as a progressive, I believe this progressivism can be found in that idea that he shares with King, though not merely as demonstrably as Martin Luther King himself did. In his Nobel acceptance speech echoing King, Obama said, quote, "Our actions matter and can bend history in the direction of justice." That was another point of that idea. But to illustrate this similarity more vividly between King and Obama, I would like to compare a portion of King's thought from one of his best-known speeches to parallels in Obama's second inaugural address. Everyone is familiar, of course, with the closing refrains of Martin Luther King's "I Have a Dream" speech, given at the March on Washington on August 28, 1963. What most people are unfamiliar with, unfortunately, are the opening paragraphs of that speech, which in their imagery, I believe, are both brilliant and very captivating. In that speech, and it's a shortened version, in that speech, King said the following, quote, "Fivescore years ago, a great American in whose symbolic shadow we now stand signed the Emancipation Proclamation." Of course, he was standing right in front of the Lincoln Memorial with Lincoln looking over his shoulder. So the reference of 50 years ago is an invocation of the rhetoric of the Gettysburg Address. But 100 years later, King said, we must face the tragic fact that the Negro is still not free. 100 years later, that life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. In a sense, King said, we have come to our nation's capital to cash a check. When the architects of our republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution and the Declaration, they were signing a promissory note to which every American was to fall heir. This note was a promise that all men would be guaranteed the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It is obvious, King went on, it's obvious today that America has defaulted on this promissory note insofar as her citizens of color are concerned. Instead of honoring the sacred obligation, America has given the Negro people a bad check, a check which has come back marked insufficient funds. But, he says, and I love this sort of rhetoric, we refuse to believe that the bank of justice is bankrupt. We refuse to believe that there are insufficient funds in the great vaults of opportunity of this nation. So we have come to cash this check, a check that will give us upon demands the riches of freedom and the security of justice. Those are incredibly sore. As a rhetorician, he was a genius, brilliant. But he was a genius here because King had the distinct ability to speak to two audiences at the same time. He could talk to his narrow parochial audience of African-American followers in an idiom that was religious very often, while at the same time speaking to America in general, because he knew he needed the support of white liberals in order to push forward the agenda of the civil rights movement. And so he could actually speak to two audiences at the same time. And I say to myself, when I look at these opening paragraphs of the I Have a Dream speech, What could be more American than talking about cashing a check, right? And so on and so forth. I mean, the idea of, right, the employment of money in that is really exquisitely American. And I think he knew exactly what he was doing when he invoked that metaphor. In that speech and many others, I think King revealed himself not to be anti-American, nor was he an American on the other extreme, an American nationalist, but rather what we might call, quote, an Americanist. In other words, he believed in America, not as it was, but as it could be. In his view, the vaunted ideals set forth in the Declaration were a promise which progressively over time and through human effort would be realized. As implied for King, history is a progressive unfolding phenomenon that does indeed, quote, bend towards justice. Given that Obama's inauguration fell exactly on Martin Luther King Day, he simply could not avoid appropriating King and his very ideas, especially this one, which I claim he identifies with his own. In his address, Obama says the following: "What makes us exceptional, what makes us American, is our allegiance to an idea, articulated in a declaration made more than two centuries ago. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal, and they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." Then he goes on to say, "Today, we are on a never-ending journey to bridge the meaning of these words with the realities of our time. For history tells us that while these truths may be self-evident, they have never been self-executed. That while freedom is a gift from God, it must be secured by his people here on earth." Obama then gives some examples in that brief speech of the progressive unfolding of that history. "First, we fought against tyranny to create a democracy. Then we made ourselves anew by overcoming slavery. Then we created a government that recognized its responsibility to the vulnerable and to the victims of undeserved misfortune." Then truly in the spirit of King, he invoked the following, quote, "We the people declare today that the most evident of truths, that all of us are created equal, is the star that guides us still, just as it guided our forebears through Seneca Falls and Selma and Stonewall. Just as it guided all those men and women, sung and unsung, who left their footprints along this great mall to hear a preacher say that we cannot walk alone, to hear a king proclaim that our individual freedom is inextricably bound to the freedom of every soul on earth." The reference to Seneca Falls, of course, points to the historic conference called by the suffragists Lucretia Mott and Elizabeth Cady Stanton in that town in the Finger Lakes that launched the feminist movement and the long march to women gaining the right to vote in a struggle that was to last 72 years. Seneca Falls Conference was really quite amazing. It was called in 1848 by Lucretia Mott and Elizabeth Cady Stanton and other suffragettes, women who became suffragettes, as it were, for the feminists of their day, to launch what was the first wave of the American feminist experience. Okay, they brought together about 300 people, most of them women, of course, in order to declare their rights. And there's a lovely little historical footnote to that, which I really cherish. The news of the Seneca Falls Conference reached far, and it reached the ears of a then newspaper editor and publisher in Rochester, New York. Does anyone know who that was? It was Frederick Douglass. And Frederick Douglass, hearing of the Women's Rights Conference at Seneca Falls, made the journey from Rochester to Seneca Falls, not all that very far. And in the original manifesto of that declaration, the women thought that to make the demand for the right to vote was just too radical. And Frederick Douglass assumed the platform and basically inspired his sisters to make that a demand of the Seneca Falls Conference. Okay, very interesting confluence. And indeed, for years, there was a historical solidarity between feminists and those people working for the abolition of slavery. But you know what? After the Civil War, when blacks were granted their right to vote, many feminists felt betrayed because the abolitionists gave up their cause of women's rights. And so those two movements departed. What's interesting also is the 300 or so women who were gathered there in Seneca Falls in 1848, only one of them lived long enough to actually cast a vote in 1920. Very interesting. It took a long time. It was a long struggle. Seneca Falls. And of course, Selma refers to the marches from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama, that were major milestones in the civil rights movement. And Stonewall, needless to say, refers to the riot right here at the gay bar in Greenwich Village in 1969, when gays, rather than submit to arrest, fought back, thus launching the gay rights movement. That Obama sanctioned, I should say, Stonewall in the context of Seneca Falls and Selma provided not only an irresistible, alliterative flourish, okay, in his oratory about it, you know, Seneca Falls, Selma, Stonewall, but I think was highly significant, controversial, and I think a little bit courageous in that he elevated the gay struggle to the historical significance of a bona fide civil rights struggle, and therefore implicitly on par with the movement for black equality. It is that parity which Southern black community, especially in the black churches, have resisted, and Obama bucked that resistance to put himself squarely, you know, on the table and saying the gay rights movement is a bona fide civil rights movement, and he can voice it with the civil rights movement in the same sense. But Obama, as I said, he clearly put his cards on the table. My point, however, is that the invocation of these great ethical and transformative movements reflect Obama's philosophical understanding of America starting with the rights enshrined in the Declaration and progressively widening the circle of inclusion to welcome in those who had previously been excluded through the denial of their rights. It is America making good on its promissory note, as King would have had it. I'd like to ask that you hold that idea about freedom being bound to the freedom of others in your mind, because it is absolutely central, I think, to Obama's philosophy. He then went on to call for women's equality and the full equality of gays, which we can assume is an indirect affirmation of gay marriage. Once more, this motif of an unfolding America that through our efforts widens the circle of equality and inclusion is an underlying theme which comprises Obama's philosophical view of the world, history, and society. He could have spoken of other things, but I think it is significant that he chose this particular theme. But there's a second philosophical motif which is far more striking in his inaugural address. In that short speech, he uses the word, quote, together, no fewer than five times, and he expresses the value of togetherness many times more. Quote, together we discover that a free market thrives when there are rules, end quote. Quote, together we resolve that a great nation must care for the vulnerable, end quote. Quote, my fellow Americans, we are made for this moment, and we will seize it so long as we seize it together, end quote. But Obama elaborates this idea even more pervasively in the following phrases. He says, quote, preserving our freedoms ultimately requires collective action, end quote. He says, quote, no single person can train all the math and science teachers we'll need to equip our children for the future or build the roads, etc., end quote. In other words, building America is not the product of individual heroism, but of collective action. He proclaims that we cannot care for the older generation while we take from the younger one. Rather, as implied, America is seamless, and we need all care for each other across generations. And pervading his presentation is a benevolent view of government, not as an enemy, but as an expression of our joint common interests, which helps people to close the gaps of gross economic inequality, supports the vulnerable who are victims of misfortune, and as mentioned, provides those entitlements that don't turn us into dependent moochers and takers, but in fact make us freer and stronger. What does this say, I'm asking, about Obama's philosophical commitments deep down? It doesn't say that Obama is a socialist, but it does say that Obama is a type of communitarian, a communitarian. In briefest terms, communitarianism is a social and political philosophy that emphasizes the importance of community in understanding political life, human identity, and a flourishing society. Communitarians typically stress the importance of the common good, communal relations, shared core values, and the individual's responsibility to society as a whole. Communitarians like John Dewey, the humanist, for example, would argue that individuals become themselves and find meaning in life because we are actively engaged and embedded with others. And an individual outside of society is virtually, therefore, a contradiction of terms. Communitarians generally emphasize not so much individual rights, but social goods. Not that they don't believe in individual rights, but they believe foremost in social goods. What is good for society, therefore, becomes good for the individual. And to protect individual rights, as Dewey said, is basically not merely to protect the rights of the individual, but to lead to a shared, common, benevolent society, and a democratic one as well. This feature of Obama's thought, I think, is quite striking. If he were a conservative or a Republican, for that matter, he most likely would have used his inauguration speech to extol the virtues of individual liberty, would have contrasted the freedom of the individual with the stifling character of government, and would have sung the praises of free market, unfettered by government intrusion. But he did not do this. In fact, he did quite the opposite. Most people who are familiar with communitarianism at all were most likely introduced to it in the 1970s by the sociologist Robert Bella, who's still around, and his colleagues in a path-breaking book entitled Habits of the Heart. That was a very popular academic book written for the public in the 1970s by Robert Bella and three other sociologists and philosophers. According to Professor Kloppenberg, Obama was introduced to communitarian thought when it entered legal theory and was part of fervent debate at Harvard Law School. He learned his communitarianism from a cluster of esteemed professors. The most notable, perhaps, were Michael Sandel, who's one of the superstar professors at Harvard, Robert Putnam, who was a brilliant political and social theorist, and the legal theorist Cass Sunstein, who had a position in Obama's administration in the first term. These were among his mentors that taught him the virtues of communitarianism. So here it is. Obama's political philosophy, and we assume his vision for America. It is a vision that veers towards progressivism, but is incremental, pragmatic, and some might say overly cautious. I should say one thing that's very important, and here I stand in a critical relationship to Obama. His progressivism does not have much of a feel or appreciation for the great economic struggles of the 19th and 20th century. There's no sensibility about the role of unionism and union struggles, do you know what I'm saying, in his progressivism, which from my where I stand is you know, absolutely critical. But you know, I'm older, I must admit, I'm 65 now, I'm older than he is. And it's hard to say, he's the first president who's been younger than me, and you know, when the Playboy bunnies and the presidents are younger than you are, that's really, that's a bad joke. You know, and I think, and I've talked about this from the platform before, he was born before the modern wave of the feminist movement, or he came to age before that movement. He was born before the anti-war struggles, or he came to age before them. He was not part of the civil rights movement. He was born after it. And therefore, he's, I think, a thinker who is not bound to ideology very much. I'm motivated. Coming out of the New Left, my politics were really highly ideologically motivated by those great ideological struggles of that period. Obama was not, and I think his progressivism is far more pragmatic and not, in fact, rooted in an ideological, but being clear about this discourse. And I think it's a function of, you know, his times. Everybody is a creature to a great extent of their times, and I think his intellectual socialization was a critic of his times. But nevertheless, having said that, his vision is nevertheless one, I think, that is egalitarian, and concludes that gaping economic inequality between the classes is not just, and moreover, is not good for the health of democracy and American society. That's a type of communitarian notion. It's a vision that understands that we're all in this together and may underlie in part why Obama has not played up his racial identity and why he often falls back on the refrain that he sees neither red states nor blue states. He wants to see us, in effect, all together, common good, common society. And this is a vision that is inspired by the ideal, as I'm saying, of the common good, that we cannot be in it just for ourselves, that we have not only rights, but responsibilities to one another and duties to society as a whole. Liberty is crucial, no doubt, but so is cooperation, responsibility, and an active concern for others. In my view, there is much in this philosophy that's very attractive, but I am not blind, I should say, to its omissions. It tells us nothing about Obama's militarism and his communitarian emphasis, and I sort of, this is hard for me to really sort of reconcile to accept, his communitarian emphasis may be a clue to his checkered, if not lamentable, record on civil liberties. Except for abolishing torture, I would say his civil liberties record is not very distinguishable from George Bush's. And this is odd, because he often likes to, with some sense of pride, say that he was once indeed a constitutional professor, which he was at the University of Chicago. And yet I think the weakest part, from where I stand, others may have different opinions, the weakest part of his politics has been, I think, a very tepid appreciation for civil liberties. I mean, look at the debate just in the New York Times today about drone warfare and the constitutional issues that that raises. And he has not been, I think, a champion of civil liberties at all. Well, anyway, such are the philosophical commitments, I believe, of our president. If I had more time, I would speak at great length about his pragmatism, his philosophical pragmatism, which is something that I tried to address in a platform a while back. But nevertheless, these values that I put forward, his progressivism and the spirit of Martin Luther King, unfolding the American society, and his communitarianism are pillars of what makes Barack Obama who he is. It's where he's philosophically anchored. Whether it's a philosophy that will serve him in good stead in the rough and tumble world of politics as he enters his second term, well, friends, that remains to be seen.